an economic collapse coming, first of all. Some will say, I'm surmising that there is. Maybe I need some challenging on that. So I'll just go very short bullet points why I think, and this is not the most conclusive study. I want to get into the trades and the themes, because that's what I'm all about. We love trades. We like big macro trades. So we look across all markets, and we like to see how the money's flowing in this huge system that is the global macro system. So we've got growing US and global debt. So all big nation states have been synchronized into a highly indebted state. China at one point wasn't, and then literally provided all the heat in the economy post 08, 09, and went from being virtually unindebted to ridiculously over-indebted. Australia sort of skipped through the 07, 08 crisis a little bit, a lot on the China heat. They now having their property bust and are heavily indebted. So every large macro nation state, we're all lepers now in the leper colony. You can't get to be a good guy who's played prudent economic policy. We're all over indebted. What else is happening? Growth rates are slowing, and we'll come back to that as to why. And it's got a lot to do with debt. I mentioned Reinhardt and Rogoff, who did an incredible study. Roughly when you get to around 90% of debt with reference to your GDP, any further debt added is counterproductive. In other words, for every dollar you add in debt, you get less than a dollar of growth. So it's kind of like me selling 20 Rand notes for 10 Rand. It's not a good business to be in. Doesn't go well, you don't make any money. Corporate debt. So a lot of the subprime was a lot about the housing collapse and the securitized, we call them securitized CDOs, but they were just basically investment, high yield investments that people bought into. They were totally toxic. There's going to be a lot more about corporate debt. So particularly in the States, they've borrowed to buy their own stock back. Why? Because the rates are ridiculously low. So we have a shocking monetary policy that's largely ineffective, that is so, so low. So corporations are borrowing and buying their own shares because the earnings and the dividends are more expensive than paying the loan. So they're buying themselves back. This is kind of one of the reasons why the market is growing so strongly outside of quantitative easing, which is coming back into favor. The Fed did a huge U-turn. So this is US. America is such a big economy, it matters. I know we get very involved with the South African-based issues here, but we're part of this whole machine, and we're a small part. And the big driver that has been America and the currency of the globe, in essence, they did a major U-turn. They were supposed to be reducing their balance sheet, and they were supposed to be upping interest rates. We did predict that they would do a very quick U-turn, and it would be an egg and chin moment. They've gone and done that. So suddenly, while they were supposedly diverging from the rest of the world that were low interest rates and sick as canaries, they suddenly had to admit they weren't as much stronger than they thought. You've got subprime cars. You've got student loans. So they've repeated what they did in housing for all sorts of consumer goods. So consumer expenditure high, cars insane. When I'm in the States, 7 years to, you get 70-month purchase plans on cars. Everyone doesn't even know the price of the car in many instances. They just know, can I afford the payment? They might be buying 50% of the vehicle over the better part of 7 years. I think my father paid off his house in around about that amount of time in the more prudent times. So it's just bizarre. Low interest rates, negative interest rates, its effect on bank profitability is brutal. In other words, banks are being killed. You probably all heard the rumors around Deutsche Bank. They're not the only sickie in the room. There's many, many banks with huge derivatives that are often based on these things, that this particular monetary system that we're in that has virtually no real interest rates, because you've got to remember there's inflation out there, and in many instances in Europe, largely negative interest rates. In Denmark, by the way, you actually have a negative mortgage. So you borrow X, and even without making payments, it goes down. Get your head around that. It's a total quantum universe that goes on. You've also had a couple of political machinations. Draghi was very much the ex-Goldman Sachs banker and head of the ECB, so it was very much banker-led in the EU, and the EU is a huge problem. And now we've got a political lawyer who's replaced her. The IMF head, Lagarde, is coming in. This tells me this is going to be about political mediation and negotiation. You've not even got a finance man in charge. They're preparing the people for the task at hand that is coming, gentlemen. The shoe's going to drop. Most non-dollar denominated central banks are now universally buying gold. So Germany, for the first time in 21 years, started adding to its gold stockpiles. Russia and China are ripping it up, and that's with China as the biggest gold miner. So they mine 425 tons a year. They sell none of it. Hong Kong has tons of imports of gold still coming in net. So these guys are building gold and they're not interested in adding to their T-bills of US dollar denominated debt. So that is flatlining. So what else is going on? Too much high yield corporate debt. So here's what's happening. We've got a whole bunch of legacy corporates. Think GE, used to be an absolute stalwart, a blue chip in the States. And they are in a situation now where certain people think they're going to go bankrupt. So there's an overhang of mega corps that are over indebted that are just one level higher than junk status. Junk status. Now, the problem when you lose that level and you go to junk status, and this is kind of, we've had a bit of that with Moody and the Rand in South Africa, is once you drop to that level, pensions can no longer hold that as an asset. One of the biggest investors in these assets are, of course, institutional money on behalf of pension schemes. So you suddenly will have this huge overhang that if correctly rated, corporations drop down to where they should be, you're going to have a flood. A high yield market is not very liquid. It's where you buy struggling companies and you get paid a bit of a higher percentage, but some of them still can go bankrupt. It's a lot more racy. Now you're going to have a huge overhang of corporations that could be dropping down into this segment. So the junk market is going to get bigger and these ratings are not being done. Much like the subprime, you may remember S&P, Moody's, all of these guys behind the curve and valuing things at AAA. I call it the portfolio of alchemy. You take absolute shit, if you'll excuse the phrase, fertilizer. You slice it and dice it and segment it by, oh, this one's from that area, that one's from that area. And now suddenly, because you've created a portfolio, you've removed all the risk, and now it's alchemy, it's gold. And now you can sell it to investment banks as true work. What's going to happen here is you're going to probably have very much a similar notion. And I'll refer back to that analogy. Something else that's going on. Who's noticed that there's a bit of a green drive going on? Well, the IMF, which transcends nation states, and is this, call it, some will, the conspiracy guys will call this the New World Order banker of choice, is now using green emergency narrative type talk and referencing quantitative easing in the same sentence. So if you just look at the dark blue bottom half, and we'll make these slides available through SlideShare later for those of you who want to read more of the detail. Green QE and collateral frameworks. What this means is they're going to proliferate currency for what they deem green-friendly corporations. So they're going to print money for these businesses, whether they're financially viable or not. In other words, there's going to be a proliferation of your local currencies, dollars and everything, and QE is here to stay. We totally back in it. Quantitative easing. In other words, using the issuance of money. Get over the concept of a fixed supply of money that is only marginally growing. There's going to be more of that. That means currency devaluations across the board. But if you get all the lepers in all the leper colony to do the same sick things, the relative valuations of currency may not change, providing they're doing it to the same proportion. So understand that. Just because you're saying, well, the euro hasn't gone much down to the dollar or X, Y, and Z. Remember, they're all parachutists that have jumped out of the plane. The plane is gold. They're in free fall. They look at each other and say, I'm doing okay relative to you. But they're all going to hit the ground at some point relative to the aircraft that is still up there. Now, another reason why I see that we're coming into a major economic event. We're coming into people, and this is not being a drama queen. This is not into, I've been preparing for this for a long, long time. I was in the property game in 2008, as well as trading. We've seen it. They never dealt with any of those issues. Yield curve inversion. Now, many people's eyes glaze over, so I'm going to give it really simply to you. Don't forgive me. Some of you are sophisticated and I understand everything. I'm going to talk it from the bottom up. Basically, debt, comparing one debt's tenor to another. If you subtract the long-term debt, what the interest it pays, you have subtracted the shorter-term debt's yield. So you should always have an upward rising interest curve. In other words, the longer your debts that you're tying up your money, the higher the value you get paid interest. When markets are afraid, that inverts. That means people no longer want short-term debt. They are shuffling out of the long and the yields invert. And this is what you're getting. Look here in the early 90s when we had a depression. You can see it. And note, by the way, the inversion occurs by the red. The recession comes after. Statistics always lag. You're probably in there right now. You're probably in there right now. Things are always acknowledged in retrospect. 2008 for me was a depression. It was not a recession. They managed the statistics to keep it from being a depression is a full year of negative growth. You'll get a lot of countries that did 0.1% in the final quarter. And go look into the government expenditure and the statistics and later revisions and et cetera, et cetera. So there's a lot of statistical management. Lies, damn lies, and statistics, I say, and many others. So what's happened just now in 19, we've had the yield curve reversion. This is almost 100% indicator. You've got three examples there. Every time you went into a recession, you had the 91, 92, you had the 2000 post.com that many will remember in this room, and of course you had the mother of what I still consider, as I say, a depression, 2007, 2008, and it comes after the yields have reverted back. You haven't put the genie in back in the bottle because it's spiking out of that zone. The minute you've crossed that line, buddy, you've crossed the line. It's coming. And that's generally how I view it. So hopefully, by now, some of you will be thinking, I think he's right. Maybe there's something coming. There's more that can be said, but I need to get into the good stuff. And there's other people who want to speak today. So gold, precious metals, this is going to be the macro bull that we've called for gold. So I do charting. We look at charts. These are the honesty. This is the footprints in the sand. Forget what people say. What are they doing with their money? And the footprints in the sand are the candlestick charts that you see before you right now. That is, first of all, we had a major blow-off. We called this structural setup. We called it for 1,300 when it had never gone higher than 1,000. And it actually overperformed, and it went to 1,900, and it led to some change in our theory and how we trade. But remember this, overperformance always begets future underperformance. I can't help but mention England rugby team in the semi-final when that comes to mind. They thought they had South Africa, they had it done. Sorry, guys. And many other instances in the fight game and in life and in trading. You overshoot, you later undershoot. Why? Because it's a blow-off moment. Everyone and his dog no longer asking price, they just have to be in. That's never good, dot-com boom, many other examples, so on. Then we get this long congestion, this indigestion period that has to be worked off. That is the circular bottom that I'm giving you over there. And then that key level, I'm kind of cupping it. There's versions of inverted head and shoulders there. There's a lot of TA. I don't want to overwhelm you. Some of you might not be into it. You get a squeeze. We called a breakout at 1350 and said this is a secular change back into bull. In fact, on the super macro, I think we've always been in bull. We've just had a seven-year pullback. Remember, this traded at $200. $250 during Brown's bottom, which was Gordon Brown, who dumped all England's gold at the $250 mark, which he's not easily going to forget. Anyway, so we've broken out of that. And what's happening now? We're having a small bull market correction. Don't get shaken out. People trade the short-term tick. Remember, technical analysis is not just about timing. If it's just about timing for you, look at bigger time frame charts. That's your whole picture. This is a big move that's coming, and this is against the dollar, by the way, which has been relatively one of the strongest currencies. So I'm going to show you the gold against the euro. That is actually one of our bespoke setup. I'm doing it in a very granular draw. You'll learn a lot more about it if you decide to join our community. But that's in a breakout, and I've given you the next target for the euro. In fact, it's at our second interim. So we have interims and steps where we expect the metal to go and when we expect it to rest. So we have a predetermined stop loss, a triggered entry point that's on a pending order, and a target, and that's the target for this particular pattern setup. Remember, others will form as this whole thing rolls out. Remember, QE is coming. It's coming back. The Fed has done their U-turn. That means proliferating more of their ridiculous paper money and digits in the bank accounts that they do, and devaluing you and essentially taxing you. That is how the central banking cartel operates, and this is why gold is in those markets. If you think it's different, so I've shown you the dollar, I've shown you the euro. For those of you that might have English interest, that's against the pound. Very, very similar footsteps in the same sand. So it's no different across the fiats. And by the way, Australia, with their devaluation, that's Australia. So it's not just about the rand, it's global. This is global. This is gold making ground against bad fiats. I'll introduce some of you to this. Again, I'm not sure of everyone's technical analysis standards or how much you follow gold, but one of the key charts that we look at is the gold-silver ratio.